Alain Gerard is proposing stiffer penalties for all companies who engage in spillage or the activities that contaminate the environment. This proposition comes amid the recent oil spill in Nambi Bauchi State. Our Minister of State for Environment, Sharon Ikezo, says the government is reviewing the law establishing the National Oil Spillage Detection and Response Agency to mete out tougher sanctions on erring companies and those polluting the environment. Ikezo confirms that OML 29 oil spill in Nambi has been brought under control. Recovery and remediation efforts are also reported to have started.
There are reports that the federal government has directed ITO Eastern Exploration and Production Company Limited to stop operating in the Nambi oil spill area in Bauchi State, pending when proper investigations are concluded into the immediate and remote causes of the ongoing natural disaster in Nambi.
Now, the ultimate public concern about oil spills in the Niger Delta continues to revolve around environmental pollution and degradation. Most of the damage done cannot be reversed, according to some expert analysis. And for certain stakeholders in the oil-rich region, what rankles more is the perception that government hasn't been diligent in making the big oil companies operating in the region to comply with safety guidelines. For more on this, we are now being joined by Joseph Ever, who is a national coordinator of the Ijo Monitoring Group, and Andrew Oro, ITO Director for Community Safety, whose company has been at the center of the current situation. I want to say good afternoon, gentlemen, and welcome to Newsday.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon. Good afternoon.
And I would like to start with you, Mr. Joseph Ever, since your community has been, the community is the one affected here. How has been the community so far in the last couple of days? How are they feeling? How has been the mood like in the community since this oil spill over 3 weeks ago?
Yes. This crime against our environment, it's a crime.
What makes it a crime?
Yes. The oil company and other oil companies committing crime against our people, against our environment.
What's the crime?
Polluting the environment, killing all our agricultural gifts from Almighty God, including the pollution of the water.
All right.
Now, as we speak, the pollution has flowed around the entire coastal line. I'm here first to thank Arise TV. What you are doing it for humanity. You will not know. You are exposing the wickedness of the oil companies. For the past 1 week, you are exposing all the wickedness. I thank Almighty God for what you are doing for humanity, for your children yet unborn, even if you are not from this environment. Now, my bitterness today is that our Niger Delta governors, we are ashamed of you people. We are ashamed of you people. Because by now, we expected the old Niger Delta governors to move down to this oil company's headquarters and arrest all the workers there. It happened in civilized societies. If the federal government cannot help us, if the federal government is helpless, why our Niger Delta governors? When we are seeing what the Southwest governor, if this thing has happened in Lagos, Ogun State, or in Ekiti State, you will see the Southwest governors mobilize and save their generations yet unborn. Our governors, we are ashamed of you. We don't know why you people are, you are afraid in this country. A state like Zamfara have gold, and all the people there are involved in gold diamond and activities. The one that we say federal government property, these oil companies are just messing up our life, and nobody's interested.
All right. Mr. Eva, so sitting next to you is Mr. Oru, and I'm going to give you a chance to rebut as someone who works for the oil companies. And, you know, this is quite an uncomfortable situation. We have had a couple of your representatives from ITO come to speak on the program. Can you give your own side as to the recovery efforts and the cleanup and the huge catastrophe that has just taken place?
Yeah, thank you very much. First and foremost, I wish to make it very clear that our hearts as an establishment go out to the impacted communities in all of this. As you very well know, and as I've stated in my last interview, The cause of the spill is yet unknown. The exact level of impact is yet unknown. These are things that are to be determined along the currents of time as we progress, you know, in terms of investigation, independent investigations, joint independent visits, and all of that. And I believe that at the end of the day, we will know who exactly has committed a crime against humanity or against the community. But let us be mindful of the fact that this is not an ethnic cleansing activity. It is not something that you just bring directly to the doorsteps of just the oil companies. There are different reasons, there are different factors that can bring about situations like this. When you're talking about oil exploration, oil exploitation, oil activities, even the natives are involved in the communities, even in the companies. They are involved in the oil production process as a result of the Local Content Act. They are actively involved. And so when you're talking about companies, you're actually talking of an establishment that is made up of a mix of all Nigerians, even foreigners, and what have you. So it's not, when you just call it companies as if it's something from the space, it is not. Then, to take it a bit further, you know, when you're talking about a crime committed by a company, that means you have come to a determination already that it is a company that is culpable or responsible for what has happened. That we have not reached that point yet. We're still at the point at which we are trying to put out the fire before we begin to find out the real cause of the fire.
Has the oil well been capped?
Well, you are going ahead of me. I was just going to put something across to you. You see, I'm trying to be sure that we don't get misunderstood. It's, you know, the people out there are mostly ignorant. Their hearts and minds are therefore very fertile in terms of information. But it is very, very, very dangerous to deliberately push out misinformation. There was a news item by which it was stated that the wellhead, for example, was on fire. There was nothing like that. And then when you come out at the end of the day and begin to say the oil companies are the ones who are responsible, it means you are foreclosing the result of the investigation that is yet to be carried out. It's not just an oil spill. This is a very unusual situation in which we find ourselves. And we've made it very clear that on our own part, while not indicting anybody for this moment, we are at least 80 to 90% sure that this was an act of sabotage. It's unfortunate the impact is directly on certain communities, and we're doing all we can to contain the spill, the damage, and at the same time to control the further damage to the communities. We have reached out to the communities. The communities are very, as far as we are concerned, they are very receptive and very cooperative. You know, there are a few individuals who try to drive this narrative in such a way as to cause dissonance between us and the communities, because they seem to benefit from it. You understand what I'm saying?
Right.
You know,
huh? Let me just come in here, because since you've mentioned the communities,
yeah.
And I would like to throw it to Dr. Ever here. Let's get it here. Mr. Ever, rather.
Yeah.
Yes, Mr. Ever here. We want to hear from you. What has the company done in terms of remediation? What has the company done to ensure that the lives of the people who have suffered gravely directly from this spillage has been a little bit better than it is or than it was?
You know, as soon as I'm respecting my brother here because we are in a public place. If not,
thank you.
He has directed a lot of words insulting us. And people who know me, I don't tolerate those things. You are punishing us, making money from those things, building skyscrapers in Abuja.
As much as possible. Keep it to the question. I asked this direct question.
Now.
In terms of remediation.
No, don't. We are not even getting to that level. These people, can he tell us the age limit of the pipes? Can he tell? These pipes were there maybe even before independence. Where is the environmental impact assessment? I went to put a panel. We want all the oil companies to carry out environmental impact assessment as far as their pipes are concerned. Since the days of Olebriti today, Oputa told me my petition is dangerous. The secretariat. Is not this battle did not start today? This is a new oil company. So when they come and speak English and talk about sabotage, and they sabotage justice in order to even make money within their oil establishment. The Nigerian people, the foreigners. I went to court to stop dredging of River Niger because of environmental problem.
But do you have proof that the oil companies are the ones sabotaging their own establishment.
What is the age limit of those pipes before you change them? The pipes that are under the ground. At least we are all human beings. We think even if we finish only primary school, what is the age limit in other countries, in Libya and here? When did they change those pipelines? When did they? Because they are in a country where the oil companies have a parallel government.
No, Mr. Evans, you seem to be mixing issues here. We are talking about the immediate effect of this particular
spill. Your people were there online, and the people said they received 2 bags of rice, 4 bags of somebody. The PRO of this company came here. I was watching him. I recorded what he was saying. Your people are live there. Your cameras were live there. Ovietimi George was live there. The people are complaining about feeding the dislocation of everything that is in within that environment. Then the other man came here, put on suit to be telling lies, the spokesman. It happened. You were watching it. So we are not talking about those, what do they do? We are talking about these things we continue, and our life, our environment is our life. That is what we are fighting. In the next 100 years, we are no more. What happened to our children in the next 100 years in that environment? These business people are not interested. That is why we are battling them. Right. That was why we stopped the dredging of River Niger. Abacha said all land and water belong to government. I told Abacha, in the name of Ijaw National Congress, all land and water belong to government. It's on piece of paper. Nobody will dredge our waterway from Warri to Abuja and give seaport to Abuja when our seaports are dead. Our seaports are dead. Mm. You are using our seaport, our oil money to build ship house in Abuja. Call it NPA house.
Mr. Eva.
Is the ship house there now?
Mr. Eva, thank you for that. Mr. Oru, we're going to give you a chance to rebut in terms of the compensation for those affected. I mean, it's clearly a touchy subject. People's livelihoods, lives, health, you know. I'm sure you've heard this ad nauseum, but still, you are the representative here. What do you have to say in terms of compensation and in terms of the fact that some people feel like the oil companies are not maintaining their pipes and other facilities in order to make this a safe transaction for everyone in the community?
Well, first and foremost, the talk about maintenance of facilities and the age of the pipelines and all of that goes into the realm of very serious regulations and technical empirical analysis. We took over those pipelines just about 5-6 years ago from Shell, that's the NCTL. And at the time we're taking them over, part of the presentation that was given to us by Shell was that all those pipes had just been changed. And I'm not sure there's anywhere in the world where pipes of 5-6 years gets corroded so quickly. And secondly, we are not all unfamiliar with the fact that there's a lot of vandalization of pipelines. Whether they are new or old doesn't have anything to do with vandalization. Whether it's new or not, if it is vandalized, it is vandalized. So why we keep maintaining that we do not want to indict anybody, I can tell you something. I am the global group director in terms of the group, ITEO, for asset protection, community relations, security matters, and all of that. They're all under my portfolio, so I know what I'm saying. We have a lot of security details at our disposal to almost ground the fact and suspicion that this present unfortunate incident most probably is due to sabotage. But we'll get there when we get there. And he who asserts must prove. If he asserts that the pipes are corroded, well, he has an opportunity along the way to establish that. But we're not going to all of that. Now, coming back to the issue of palliatives and all of that, and the compensation, we have not gotten to the stage of compensation yet. Compensation is when we are found culpable as an establishment in terms of what caused the unfortunate incident. All we are doing for now is because we believe that in any environment in which you are operating, you are a native, and the pains of the people are your own pains. So in terms of what we're doing is in terms of corporate social responsibility, we're empathizing with the people. We have immediately this thing happened. I personally, at my level, went there to make a delivery of very huge items. How they distributed them within the communities, I don't know. Whether some people got 1 cup of rice or 10 cups of rice or 2 bags of rice, I wouldn't know. But what we sent there immediately, within 48 hours of my giving my word, and the community can testify to it, was quite a lot. And I'm sure you have some of the records. And giving out palliatives in situations that is an ongoing process. It's not something you just do once and go away.
No, but because if the people keep insisting, because this, they haven't received there's been the story of just people getting two cups of rice. There's been a story about two bags of rice being distributed. And you are saying, or you had your spokesman saying that over 200 bags came into the community. But the community keeps insisting. You have someone sitting beside you, and we've had people say, just two bags of rice. Okay. Or individuals got just two cups of rice.
Okay, can I come in at this point? First and foremost, I don't think it's from that immediate environment, that community itself, Opunembe.
Okay.
So you may not have the full details. Secondly, it is not true that we gave two bags of rice and all of that, whatnot. You have the records. You've shown them on your station before. The minimum we gave to them, first and foremost, was 200 bags of rice. So much. And let me weigh in here. What I'm saying is that we did not go there to say, this is all you're having. How it is distributed, we even gave them money with which to distribute to the hinterlands. And we are going again. It's a continuous thing. Do you understand what I'm saying? Because you feed somebody today, you don't feed him tomorrow, you don't feed him the next day, you don't take off his medicals. We're coming up with medical outreach, we're coming up with different programs. But as an immediate palliative measure, we sent in 4 or 5 trailer loads of food items and medications within 48 hours of my giving my commitment. That is a strong show from the company, if you ask me.
So are you indicting the community heads you gave it to? To have embezzled all this?
Because absolutely not. I'm not indicting them. Okay. I said I'm not part of the distribution system, how it was distributed. But what we gave is quite a lot within 40 hours. And we're still giving more. And we're still doing more. And we're still going to do more. That's what I'm saying.
Four trailer loads and 2 bags of rice.
Yes.
The disparity is huge.
It's huge. That is why, in fact, I think you have a responsibility here to dispel this kind of information, because you have the records. You've shown it on your station before. You've televised it before.
I think
so you have a responsibility there too.
I think what the issue really is a community has been affected. They feel like a company has come into their community and messed it up completely. And the company who is, they feel, responsible, not giving them enough to make their lives easier. I think that's what it's not about 2 bags of rice. It's just, it feels like it's not enough being done in proportion to the damage that has been done. But I want to go back to whether or not the oil well has been capped. There's conflicting information about that, and I'm just wanting to know, in terms of the recovery effort, because we do know that there are some situations where it can go on for 6 months and there are issues with not having the capacity to cover it. So I'm wondering if it has been capped, and at least we can take that discussion a little bit further.
You see, let me tell you something. When you're talking about a well that has blown out such as this, it's an unusual one, especially when it has to do with gas, okay? And going there to put it out, like I've always tried to inform the public, is a process. As we speak, every equipment, every personnel that is required to put out that diffusion, that leakage, is on the spot right now as we speak. All the organs of government that are monitoring are on ground. All personnel that are supposed to operate the equipment are on ground. The marine spread, the safety issues have been taken care of. So it's a program. It's a full campaign. You have to understand this. It's not enough to just go down and say, I'm turning it off. No, you don't turn it off like that. If not, you cause a fire. So there are so many things involved in killing a well when there is a blowout already. If it were a well that we just wanted to kill because we don't really need it anymore, it's a different thing. You just go there 2-3 days and it's all over. We have had similar incidents in different parts of the world, including America and other claims. You know, some of them took 1 month, some took 2 months.
The Deepwater Horizon spill took 6 months, and
exactly,
they lacked the capacity.
All right,
this is not a matter of lack of capacity now. It's okay. A delicateness of what has happened.
All right, Chief, permit me to turn to Mr. Joseph Eva. And you've been speaking holistically about the activities in the Niger Delta for years and decades. The question now is, how did we get to this point whereby, because this is not an issue of 5 years, 10 years ago, this is an issue that has dragged for so long, you've mentioned that, but how did we get to this point whereby we allowed our riverines and the mangroves get this bad or get this polluted to this point?
God bless you. God really bless you. Our political leadership. We have no political leadership. In fact, the situation now, we have just cowboys as political leaders. Look at what is happening in NDDC. You weep for our generation yet unborn. Look at, it is the political leadership. Let me give you one good example of Lagos State. Last year, coronavirus, the Northern Commissioners of Education met and said, the Minister of Education told the whole nation that we are not going to partake in WAEC. The Northern Commissioners of Education assembled and said, they are going along with the Federal Minister of Education. But Lagos State Commissioner for Education sent a memo to the governor. Lagos is ready for the WAEC. Lagos is ready for the WAEC. If Ghana is ready for the WAEC, Senegal is ready for the WAEC, Gambia is ready for the WAEC, if Ghana is ready for WAEC, Lagos State is ready for the WAEC. They told those who are not ready for the WAEC, go and stay behind. We are moving forward. Commissioner of Education, Lagos State. The Lagos State governor, with other Southwest governors, mobilized. The commissioners of Southwest governors met and said, the whole Southwest will ride the WAEC. Make nonsense of the Federal Minister of Education in Nigeria. And it happened. Later, the shameless commissioners from the North now said, we are also ready for the WAEC. We wrote the WAEC. Shameless. I told them, shame on you people. When you have vibrant people, look at that woman, Commissioner of Education, physical appearance, and you see what is in their brain, you thank God that these people are part of their this generation. That the Lagos State government mobilized other Southwest. Even the other thing that killed the doctor, what is that sickness?
Yeah, Ebola.
Ebola. The Southwest governors met. They are from different political parties. They ignore that. But our South governors.
All right, Mr. Joseph, can you now dimension it to
what I am bringing about? It political will. When the political will of your people, when your people are just there, you elected them in the name of protecting us. They are not doing that. They are afraid of Abuja. They are afraid of these oil companies. Shell especially. There was a time, I tell you one story. You can carry your cameraman to Chevron. I took blind people from Niger Delta to Lagos Chevron and blocked their entrance. 2008. I block it. Wow. I say, Chevron blind their eyes. Chevron must repair their eyes. Indaro was IG. He called me from Abuja. Joseph, will you remove that blind? I say, look, you are joking. I confronted Abacha. I stopped dredging off Niger. That is, your people will not allow our water go to Abuja. We will not allow container come from London, Japan, pass through Wari to Abuja. Insult us when our seaports are all dead. You are building seaport in Baro and Abuja. We will not allow it. Today, no dredging. I told Indaru, be careful. Anybody that touches blind people, you will see what will happen in our homeland. Indaru ordered policemen from Maroko police station to Chevron headquarters to remove our blind children. When the Mumbai police got here and saw the blind people, I have the video. They say, yeah, blind people.
Mr. Eva.
If we have the political will, if our governors know why they were elected, like Southwest governors, all these communities will not come and insult us.
We've run out of time, unfortunately.
They will not insult us. Can Sarwa dive go the environment?
Thank you so much for joining us on the program. We definitely have to have you back. And Mr. Eva, Mr. Oru, have a great day, and thank you for joining the program.